Let me show you what the Spirit of God did to you when you trusted Christ. He convinced you of something. He convinced you of your sinfulness. He convinced you of your lack of righteousness and the sufficiency of Christ. And He put a terror into your heart that judgment had already come and you were bound for execution. Jesus spoke about it in John 16. Would you turn there with me? Jesus said that He was going away, and that was good, because in His finished work, now the Spirit of God would come to bring men to that knowledge. The reason that you became a Christian is because God granted you grace in Christ Jesus from eternity. 2 Timothy 1:9. It's because God knew you and loved you from eternity, and He predetermined where you would end up, because He is sovereign, He is good, He is just, and He is not fair. Aren't you glad that He can discriminately bestow His blessing upon a world of convicts? And in John 16, this is why you became a Christian. Verse 8, He, when He comes, He will elenko, convict. It means unalterable proof. It means that you can't argue. It means the video cam is on you and we can see everything that you did. It means we have the tape. That's what spiritual conviction is, where every mouth is closed and all the world is accountable to God. He will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Those three things have to occur before a man or a woman become a Christian. They have to be convinced of the fact of their sinfulness. They have to be convinced of the fact of their lack of righteousness, and to be convinced that judgment is not a fantasy, that it's coming. In verse 8 or 9, concerning sin, because they do not believe in Me. Now, what that simply means, if you were a non-Christian, I would say to you that you have sinned, and your sin is so heinous that it cannot be winked at. Jesus Christ has come and died. And because of that, your sin has been paid for. All that is needed is for you to believe in Him. So wicked is your sin that it cannot be absolved, it cannot be scoured away. It had to be punished in the Son of God. The only thing that can send you to hell is the rejection of the sin bearer. And so the Holy Spirit convicts us of the unalterable, immedicable, irremedial villainy of our condition. That there is no argument, and I've noticed this incidentally, whenever I lead someone to Christ, I always feel like, boy, was that easy. How could I ever get any kind of reward for that? Because when the Spirit of God affects a man or a woman's heart, and you tell them that they are sinners, they nod, yes, sir. When you say to them that there's nothing they can do, they say, amen. And when you say to them that Jesus died, you see the tears fill up in their eyes, and the fruit drops off of the tree. Because the Spirit of God has convinced them that only Christ can deal with their sin. Secondly, concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father, which means that there is one person who is acceptable before God as righteous, and that is the one who ascended and sat down. How do I preach that? What it means is this, that if you are here this morning as a non-Christian, all of the good deeds that you have done not only will not avail you before God, but they hypothetically make God more angry when you try to present them. Because it's a statement that you're not that bad, He's not that holy, and Christ is not that good. Concerning righteousness, He convinces the world that their righteousness is filthy rags. Or as the Hebrew says, the rags of uncleanness. Or literally, the rags of the times. It's a woman's menstrual rag. That's how God sees your good deeds. They are contemptible. They are noxious. They are grotesque. There is but one way you can be counted righteous. How? He has gone and died and ascended to the Father. He is the Holy One of God. And the Spirit of God convinces us of this. And He convinces us of judgment. In verse 11, that the ruler of this world, meaning Satan, has been judged. Meaning that evil has already been sent to Goliath. His head has been severed. The enemy is beaten. There is no hope. You do not wait for your judgment. You do not wait for your tribunal. You wait for your execution. You will not be brought to a court to argue. You will be brought to a court to be banished. Judgment has fallen, and it's also a great encouragement that I can escape judgment because it's fallen on Jesus Christ, who punished sin and nature's might. Now that's what the Spirit of God convinces men of, the finished work of Christ, and that I am sinful, I am unrighteous, and I am worthy of damnation. Christ bore my sin, provided my righteousness, and He received my judgment and defeated the foe. It's Christ. There is nothing that separates you from God except your rejection of Christ. Should you believe in Him, those three big issues of sin, acceptability, and the escaping of the edict of banishment will have been settled in God's eyes. Now, folks, that's what the Spirit of God does in evangelism. And incidentally, that is why in your evangelism, don't promise people things the Bible doesn't. The Spirit of God exalts Christ. He convicts of sin. He convicts of the inability to please God and of the beauties of Christ. Don't tell people that they can trust Christ and lose that 7 pounds of ugly fat. Don't tell them that they can trust Christ and raise their SAT 50 points. Don't tell them if they'll trust Christ that God can give them a happy, meaningful life. That may be true, but they may get martyred tomorrow. They may be imprisoned next week. A lot of times in our American Christianity, we dangle a carrot that God doesn't dangle. The elect of God are brought to faith because they are convinced that they are lost and that Jesus saves. That's the reason you became a Christian.